Hi.
Hey.
How are you?
Yeah, not too bad. Yourself?
Good, good. Can you introduce yourself to our guests? You are the guest, to our audience.
Okay, so I'm Ash Ziolis. I'm currently a student at UOW in Australia, or the University of Wollongong. And I am currently in my undergraduate degree doing international relations. And I'm looking to do a master's and at Sydney University next year. And I will be off to do my PhD, hopefully, after that as well.
And you just finished a research, a paper, or what? Like, what's the...
Yeah, so I've just finished a paper on the Iranian Green Movement and the 2017 protests that subsequently happened after that. And essentially, this came out from investigating all the literature. Mm-hmm. And after investigating all the literature, I discovered a big gap. No one was speaking about the 2017 protests. And admittedly, in academia, it does take a while to get to the point. And because they were only a few years ago, not many papers have been uploaded on them. But the main sources that I had to use, unfortunately, for the paper were from just general media outlets, including the Washington Post, BBC, things like that, whilst there was a vast amount of literature on the 2009 Green Movement.
Is this an academic research paper?
Yes. Okay. Yes, it is.
And it's submitted for your master's,
No, it's actually it's submitted for as a subject at university for the undergrad.
Oh.
Yeah.
And has it been, when did you submit this?
This was on the 31st of May, I believe.
May this year, 2019.
This year, yep, this year.
And has it been reviewed and everything?
Yes, it has. It's been reviewed by two of my professors, and they've looked through and they've analyzed it and everything like that. And I told them that we were going to be doing this at some point, and they seem very excited about it. So.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah. Great. Hi, if you're watching. that's amazing. And so you're one of the first people that actually has done an academic paper on this.
Well, particularly whether or not I'm the first is questionable, because there are sources talking about the 2017 Green Movement, but nothing specifically drawing parallels between the two.
Okay, but for people that don't understand, because what you say the two, what two you're comparing two separate things. What are those two separate things that you're comparing with each other? And like, just assume that people have no idea what these, like the Green Movement and the most recent protests in Iran. You're talking about two separate protests in Iran happening at two different times, with about a decade between them, right?
Yes.
And you're comparing them with each other. And these are both anti-government protests.
Yes.
And there are some similarities between them, and there are some differences between them. And it says a lot about how far Iran has come since the original, the Green Movement protest. But can you just give a summary about each one of these before we go into your paper? Yeah, go on.
Okay. So let's begin in 1997, when Khatami first got in as a reformist candidate.
Mm-hmm.
Right, in parliament. So what happened was there were a large amounts of reformist voices coming out of Iran looking to promote reformist candidates in the parliament. They were getting tired of the Ayatollahs, they were getting tired of the mullahs, and they were getting tired of the conservative clerical caste. And what we saw was that after the evolution of 1997, we ended up getting to 2009, and about, I think it was nearly probably about a million and a bit of protesters storming the streets in opposition to the election of 2009, more like, which was between Khatami. Mousavi and Ahmadinejad. And the reformist protesters were concerned that their votes were not being heard. In fact, that was one of the chants. It was, "Where is my vote?" Because Ahmadinejad won with 63% of the vote, even though it was the largest student turnout.
Mm-hmm.
And youthful I don't know, emergence in Iran since that time. So essentially they were protesting what was perceived to be election fraud, and there were large amounts of protests in the street. And when we're talking about numbers, it's hard to say exactly how many were protesting, because a lot of it was online as well. And so essentially they were protesting a number of things, which is what I'm investigating in my paper. And it included the restrictions of personal freedoms. And that was the big thing. That was in 1996, actually, just before these reformist voices were entering parliament, such as Khatami, you had the introduction of a stricter Sharia in 1996. And so that is argued to be the push for reform in Iran at that time. And this included the restriction, or more restrictions on alcohol. This included more restrictions on Islamic dress codes and large amounts of things like this. And so the student populations were protesting in that regard.
You're still talking about 2009 right now, right?
Yeah, still talking about 2009.
All right, so now let's talk about 2017. And after you mentioned 2017, I'm just going to put everything in perspective for people, like in a summary of the timeline, and then you can tell me if that's accurate or not. So tell me what 2017 we go... do we have a name for the 2017 one?
No, because we need a hashtag 2017 Iranian protest, because that's what... people were talking about, but my argument is that the Green Movement didn't die. So if we want to call it the Green Movement 2017, we can.
Ooh, that's not going to be very popular in Iran. But okay, no. So we could talk about that. Why I think that's not going to be popular in Iran to call the 2017 protest like another version of the Green Movement, because a lot of people that contributed to the 2017 protest are anti what people demanded in the Green Movement. But I could like let you know what I think, and you did an academic research. So I listen to people from Iran and like social media and stuff, but you did a paper on it, so we could compare our perspectives from
versus academia.
Versus academia. I'm more in favor of academia than personal experiences based on what you hear. So even though my opinion might be different from yours, I might be biased towards you because, you know, I think like, I mean, I'm in favor of looking at data in a more systematic way, using models that have proven to work rather than just relying on personal experiences. So I will tell you what my personal experience is, but I'll rely more on your data than my personal experience. But anyway, so what 2017 one, can you give us? Yeah, okay.
Right. So the protests in that instance were a little bit different, because it can be argued that the catalyst was economic grievances. That was the catalyst. However, the underlying aspects to it were still in regards to the restrictions of personal freedoms and anti-government protests, as you said. Mm-hmm. And so what ended up happening was a similar instance in 2009, protests started on the streets. About 7,000 people were arrested in the get-go in the first few months. And I think there were 21 deaths, if I believe so. And once again, it was anti-government protests. They were annoyed at sanctions. They were annoyed at economic reduction of subsidies. They were annoyed at a variety of different things. However, as seen with the headscarf protests and the forcing of headscarf veilment in Iran, we had protests on the street where the Girls of Revolution Street is what they were called. And they were protesting against this forced veiling, removing their hijab and actually waving it in opposition to the forced veiling law. And this was very, very interesting. And it was just it highlighted that the restrictions of personal freedoms were still at the forefront. Because in academia and in a lot of different Western publications as well, including the BBC, you know, Washington Post, they often cited economic grievances as if they were the entirety, as if they were the big thing that was instigating these protests. But I took a look at that, and I still believe that there are parallels which can be drawn between the restrictions of personal freedoms in 2009 and 2017, and how they, I guess, establish this anti-governmental feeling amongst protesters. Okay. And so that's what happened in 2017. Once again, mass demonstrations on the streets, but this time it wasn't just the student populations. This time it was also you even had the older generations as well protesting, and the poorer and uneducated citizens as well actually protesting.
Right. So yeah. So I'll give it for people to be able to put everything in the right, because for a lot of people that are listening to this, this all seems like a mess, like, oh, protest here, protest there.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to give like a short summary of this so that people could put everything in place in their mind. So what the timeline that I'm going to look at, 1979, 1997, 2009, 2017. Okay. Yes. 1979 is when the Islamic revolution in Iran happened, and Iran became an Islamic country, Islamic government, Islamic theocracy. This is when the Pahlavi, the monarchists were removed because of mass protests in the street, and they removed the Shah, the Pahlavi dynasty, and the mullahs and the ayatollahs, they, whatever you call them, they came and they started Islamic theocracy. So that's 1979. It was extremely, at first it was a mix, this was wiped out from my history books, by the way, in Iran. It was a mix of these Marxists and Islamists trying to compete over power, but eventually the mullahs completely wiped out the Marxists, and they killed all of them in mass numbers, and they got all the power. And once they got all the power, everything, at first people that, a lot of people thought that they were going to have some freedom, enjoy a lot of freedom now, because the Shah was, the monarchs were dictators, and now this whole revolution was supposed to be for liberty, but these the mullahs became more and more theocratic, and Islam, you know, all their laws became Islamic. Women lost the right to wear what they want. In fact, there was a huge protest by women right at the beginning against that. And more everything became extremely religious, and civil liberties went out the window, right? And it became more and more extreme until 1997, as you mentioned, because the way that they structured the government is called, it's supposed to be an Islamic republic, so they had to have both Islamic elements in it and republic elements in it. So some people think that's a contradiction, and Iran, by its very nature, is a contradiction. So you have the main source of authority, which is Khamenei, which right now it used to be Khomeini, which is the supreme religious leader. But to have that republic element, you also have a parliament, and you also have a president that you vote for. Mm-hmm. So the Khatami, the president that they voted for in 1997, was somebody that seemed to suggest that people deserve to have more liberty, to, you know, cut people some break, give them some freedom, start communicating with the outside world a little bit more. They called it the Goftegui Tamaduna, which is like talking to other civilization. And people were like, yeah, finally some fresh air, like something, like we could breathe again if we elect this guy. So they went and voted for him. And I was there in Iran. I voted for Khatami. I wish I had my Shanasnami here so I could show it. What?
That's amazing. That's amazing. That's, wow.
Yeah. I wish I could. It's in my safer now. I could open it and take it out and show you the stamp. But I'm not going to do that right now. But yeah, I have the stamp for voting for Khatami. But they voted for him, and he was a celebrity. I actually saw him at a book convention in Tehran once. And he was treated like this huge celebrity in Iran. He was very, very popular. He was president for 4 years, and then he was again voted again, and he was a president for 8 years. But nothing. He got reelected, but nothing. Not much changed. A little bit. There was a little bit of sign of hope at the beginning, but people had so much hope that everything is going to be great now. Everything, like the time for religious conservative rule is over, and Khatami is going to come save us. Even though he himself was a mullah, they felt like at least he's one of the sane ones.
Yes.
But not much change, and a lot of people lost a lot of hope. People felt like, you know, we were stupid to believe that anything will change. But then again, 2009 happened. Now we had this guy with Mousavi, and he was giving people a lot more hope again, just like Khatami did. He came and said all the right things to people think that he's going to give us, you know, all, you know, the civil rights that we want, the liberty that we want. And there were so and here's the sign of his party was a green sign.
Yes.
So you saw in the streets, so many people were before the elections had green ribbons, green everything green hijab. Mm-hmm. So that he had so much support. And if you looked at the number of people that were supporting him, everybody was almost sure that obviously Mousavi would win. And this guy wasn't even a mullah, Ayatollah. He wasn't even wearing the traditional Akhund costume. So people were like voting for him. And then all of a sudden the election results came out and they said that he lost. And people could not believe that it's impossible. This guy, it was Ahmadinejad that won, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they were so angry that they were like, this is definitely fraud. It's impossible that they had some pictures and some other evidence that it was a fraud. But they were so angry that they came out in protest. And this was mostly started by university students, right?
Yes. Yeah,
and I was, even before these protests happened, I was a university student in Iran, in Tehran University. And this revolutionary zeal was felt even before these protests started. Like people, like I remember like in the middle of chemistry class, listening to watching the teacher, and then there's a song that they used to play. It's called Yar Dabistani, which is a little bit of a rebellious song against authority. Yeah. And that's just a sign, like, get the fuck out of your class. We're starting like a protest. Like, I remember, like, the teacher was teaching us, like, chemistry and stuff like that. But as soon as we heard that song, the teacher was like, okay, fine, just get out of here. And everybody left, right? And, like, the class became empty because we were all going to go, like, so this was before all, because this is, like, more 2003 or 4. So this was way before the protest. But even back then, people were like ready to like, so when this whole thing happened, people were ready to protest. And basically they came out in huge numbers and they were crushed. I mean, crushed in, like they were arrested, killed. People's kids were sent back to their parents in cement and body bags, and they were buried in unmarked graves. People were randomly killed. A lot of people killed the, you know, religious police as well. My brother's best friend was just stabbed in the stomach. My brother went to his funeral, and he wasn't even part of the protest. He just went to buy milk, and he was on the way back with he was holding like plastic bags from the grocery store, and he just got mixed in the crowd. And this Basiji guy just came in, and he just stabbed him and turned a knife and just left. But you could see that, dude, this guy is not even part of a protest. He's holding grocery bag. What the fuck? But anyways, they killed him. So it was a huge mess. It was so bloody that I thought that, okay, the government sent such a strong message to the people that there will never be a protest like this. I was convinced that it was so shocking to the parents and to the people that experienced what happened that I thought the people of Iran will probably never rise again because of the memory of the 2009 protests, right? But then I was wrong. I was wrong. I was so wrong because 2017 happened around 10 years later, right? Less than 10 years, right?
Yes.
But 8 years later, and people came out and protested again. What was the catalyst for this one? And there's a lot of conspiracy theories, and some of it accurate, some of it not so accurate, about what was the catalyst of the 29 one was very obvious, right? Yes. People were like, what the fuck happened to my vote? Where's my vote? Where's my vote? You guys stole my vote. This is a fraud election. We know what happened. But what is interesting about 2017 one is that it seemed like it was a protest started by the conservatives that backfired. Is that what your understanding is?
So before we go into that, I just want to backtrack a little bit and go actually back to 1979.
Right? Oh, wow. All the way to the beginning.
Yes, because you did actually say a few things which are very important in the discussion.
Okay.
And so in 1979, as you said, a lot of people actually supported the Ayatollah because they wanted to get rid of an authoritarian government and the Shah Pahlavi and that dynasty.
Right.
And so that was really interesting. This is why a lot of people compare 1979 to 2009. That was where it comes from. And as you rightly said, those Marxists and the Islamic or socialist grouping, more like, they wanted to reduce the privatization of banks and things like that. And so you had all this bickering in the government. You had the Islamic socialists and the conservatives, and they were bickering between each other. And then this took away from the idea of the guardianship of the jurist, if you're familiar with that concept. Or the
Velayat Faqih.
Yeah, the Velayat Faqih, yeah. And so that started to decline. And that is why reformist voices emerged, or it is argued that that is one of the reasons why reformist voices emerged, because all this bickering in the parliament then led to the Faqih not being perceived as a reliable leader. And so it started to produce more reformist voices, which is why you had 1997. That's what
1997. Okay, you mean the Khatami. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Really, is that what people say? They say like the.
It was one of the factors. So it was one of the factors, and essentially, because the Faqih was meant to represent a paternal figure controlling the Iranian population. You ended up having...
Okay, that's way too technical. I think a lot of people...
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, I think a little bit, I mean, maybe a little bit too detailed for our audience, okay? So let's do a little bit more. So here's the thing. I'm going to simplify what you said. You're just saying that some of the... some of the conflict between the people that were responsible for the Islamic Republic coming to power. The Islamic Republic crushed some of its opposition that helped the people that helped the mullahs to come into power, and the mullahs crushed them after coming to power. Some of that internal conflict kept on carrying on into the part. That's the simplified version of what you said.
It also meant the decline of religious legitimacy and the decline of religious clericism. That was what it led to, and this is why you have the restrictions of personal freedoms as a very important aspect in the 2009 protests.
Okay. But just to let you know, a lot of people in the 2017 protests will disagree with everything you're saying right now, and they would be very angry with you right now. But anyways, I'll let you know why would they be angry with you that you're saying that. But let's go to 2017, and this is what people are now remembering. And most people don't really remember what happened. Like most people here in the West or in Australia, what's fresh on their mind is the recent protest, which is the 2017 protest.
Yes.
But the reason why we're constantly we want to compare that to 2009 protests is because, I mean, to people like us, where we were very involved in following the 2009 protest, we constantly compare that to 2009 because it was very. I mean, we didn't expect this to happen again, and it happened. And in some ways, it was smaller, and in some other ways, it was much bigger, right?
Yeah.
It was in some ways, it was lower in size, but bigger in significance.
Yes.
Right? Because the number of people that showed up was less in 2017 compared to 2009. Yes. But the complaints that they had and the demands that they had were things that I never thought I would hear in the streets of any Iranian city, at least in my lifetime.
Do you mean death to the dictator?
Death to the dictator, burning Khomeini's pictures, Khomeini's picture. Some guy even burned the Iranian flag right in the middle of traffic in Tehran. Yeah, because it has the Allah symbol right in the middle. People cursing Shia holy figures like Hussein, like When I saw Khamenei's picture being burned in bit large Iranian cities, this must be an upside down world. Like, I didn't think, like, I thought this would take at least another 50 years or something like this for us to see something like this. All right. I could not believe I was, because let me tell you why this is so, this is going to make me sound like a really weird, but go. Okay. So when I was a high school student in Tehran, I saw a open letter. I think, who wrote the letter? Was it Nabavi, this famous author in Iran that wrote political commentary? But he was outside of Iran. And he wrote an open letter to Khamenei criticizing him. And I could not believe anybody had the balls. I know he was outside of Iran, but I could not even imagine that was possible for somebody to do that. I know now it's more common, but at that time I was like, oh my God, somebody like just, this is right open in the internet. And I was reading it online and I knew that I was committing a crime just even looking at this. Yeah. But I was so amazed that somebody was writing something so openly against Khamenei that I printed it. And I put it in my bag, and I put it in my school, bag, and I just went out in the street, and I just walked around with it in my bag, and I came home. Because people living in free countries, I don't think they can relate to that. But to me, I was just like walking in the street, and I was just like, I'm carrying letters in my bag that. Like, I was just, I felt like I was like doing some act of defiance because I was carrying stuff that could get me killed, but I was like kind of reclaiming, like, I wanted to do something that was not that I'm not supposed to do, because it's just like, you know how, for example, women in Iran where they're supposed to cover their hair, but they keep trying to take a little bit more,
a little bit each time.
Yeah, because it's just like, you know, you want to take a little bit of your freedom. And I wanted to just, I was just in the street with these letters and I was just constantly telling myself, like, I'm doing this and nobody knows. And I'm getting away with something that I'm not supposed to do. And for me, that was like, I was scared the entire freaking time. Like, I ran back home and I came home and I tore the letter into small little pieces. Put it in the toilet and I flushed the toilet. Like, my heart was pounding, right? So that's the environment that I was an atheist in Iran. And I told my friends that I'm an atheist. Like, I would never say publicly, because if I said it publicly, I would die, right? They would hang me. But I felt safe enough to tell them I'm an atheist. At least to my friends, to my close circles. But I wouldn't even tell my friends that, fuck Khamenei or something like that. I would think like somebody somewhere might hear me. Like, that's the something that I would not say. So for that kind of mentality, and you seeing them in the street, people burning publicly Khamenei pictures, like, I was looking at my jaw was like falling. You know, I could not fathom what was happening. But anyways, I talked too much. Go on.
No, that's okay. That's very interesting. My God, wow. Wow, that's incredible.
Right.
Essentially, I suppose looking at the evolution of the 2017 protests, there are a number of similarities between the two, which is what my paper is on. And so this is why I decided to investigate it, because this is why I wanted to see how the emergence of reformist voices was continuing and how it had evolved. And so there are four big factors that we need to look at when we're looking at the comparisons. The first one is the youthful demographic, the amount of youth in Iran. The second, including the student populations, which was obviously a huge deal for 2009. And now we need to look at social media. And social media is very significant, not because of people like Andrew Sullivan, for example, proclaiming that it was a Twitter revolution or anything like that, because it that wasn't the case. It's more the fact that it allowed videos and violent acts of the government to be shown internationally. International recognition for the violent acts that had been committed. Hashtag We Are Nida, for example, when she was unfortunately killed
That was the 2009 one, though, not the 2017 one. So you're talking about... You're talking about the role of social media in the 29 protest or in the 2017 protest?
I will draw the connection here and talk about the Girls of Revolution Street and the protests in 2017. And this is the connection. You have the usage of social media to spread these ideas and what was occurring in Iran outside of the country. In fact, the 2017 hijab protests were actually recognized by Rouhani at the United Nations, and when I say recognized, he spoke about them, which was big enough. It was a huge deal to be able to get that recognition in that regard, and that was the interesting. And then the third aspect of the connection is the decline in religious legitimacy and religious practice within the state. That is the third, and then the fourth is economics.
Right. Wait, can you say list of 1, 2, 3, 4? One is social media.
Yes.
Social media. Number two is what?
The youthful demographic.
Youthful demographic. Number three?
We'll say economics.
Economics. And number four is?
Social media.
Social media.
And that's way indicative.
Well, no, social media was number one.
Well, it isn't really ordered as such. It's not. It's not ranked in importance. It's
okay.
More
so
just,
no. Yeah. So what was it for then?
Yes.
Youth, economy, economic, social media, and what else?
Decline in religious legitimacy.
Religious legitimacy. Okay. Okay. So here's the thing, though. Before you go on with these four, I have to tell you, like with the. A lot of people might not like the fact that you're talking about the girls in the revolution. So, and I know a lot of people hate it when I say girls because some of the most of them are grown women. But yeah. the hashtag is Dokhtaraye Khiyaban Enqilab. So we're just translating the Persian version. So it's the girls of the Revolution Street, right? That the street that this started it is the its name is Revolution, which is very ironic that that's the street. So, but. A lot of people say that happened after. That was not part of the 2017 protests. That happened right after the 2017.
That was protests. In 2018 is when that all went down.
Yeah, and it was separate. It wasn't part of the protests. So a lot of people might say like it's not fair to categorize that as the 2017 protests.
I would argue that it still represents discontent in Iranian society and right. that is therefore able to link it because they did continue into 2018, those particular protests. And then it happened near a month after. So it is reasonable to say that perhaps they were
connected.
Connected, yeah. Okay. Maybe not entirely, but for sure there was some sort of...
By the way, there's a lot of conspiracy theories, but also that some people think that these women were hired by the government itself. But we're not going to go into that. I know
that's not going to that.
Okay. It's not worth. But I know a lot of people are going to get angry that we're not even considering it. But anyways.
I apologize to them in advance.
Another thing is like the key, before you go into these four, the key three figures that you have to remember, the three changing figures that you have to remember, and the one constant figure that you have to remember. So the original Islamic revolution was by Khomeini, right?
Yes.
But then Khomeini died, and then the supreme religious leader became Khamenei, right? So Khamenei is the constant in these in the 1997, 2009, and 2017, all of these time, Khamenei is the supreme religious leader. The three different things that changes is 1997, the president is Khatami, and he represents the reform, the hope for reform for people, and then the disappointment that follows. 29, Mousavi represents the hope for reform for people, and he doesn't even become president. He loses in what people consider to be fraud. And so, again, Mousavi loses, and the protest follows, and...
For anyone interested, I think it was 63% is what Ahmadinejad won by. Right. That was
right. So for Khatami, there was no protest, right? Because they won, they got Khatami, But they were disappointed that he didn't change anything. Mousavi, they thought, like, he definitely going to change things, but he didn't even want. So there was major, the greatest protest since the original 1979 Islamic Revolution. This was the biggest protest since then. Like, so Mousavi didn't win, and then Ahmadinejad became president. But then come all the way to 2017, Rouhani now wins, becomes president, and he is also seen as a reformist, as a sign of new hope for people to become, to change things. But what is different about 2017 is that when Rouhani, just like Khatami, didn't change things. So Rouhani was supposed to come and bring reform and bring all the things that people were hoping for, and none of that happens. So what happens is the 2017 protest was not anymore a fuck you to the Ayatollahs in favor of the reformists.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between this one was a fuck you to all of them combined. This was a fuck you to Khamenei, the Ayatollahs, the fundamentalist religious people, and a fuck you to the reformists as well. Mm-hmm. Because the people... most of the people in these protests were convinced that Khatami, Mousavi, Rouhani, all of these people were just false hope. They were just shiny objects to wave in front of people while these mullahs go do whatever they want.
Okay.
And the, if you could hear the chants of the people, they were saying, "Islah talab usul gara dige tamum majra." This was one of the most popular chants. They were saying, "Reformists, fundamentalists, your time is up." So they were putting them all in the same camp.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the main difference between the, to me, this is the main difference between 2017 and 2009. 2009 was people trying to support some politicians to rise up against conservative politicians.
Mm-hmm.
That was 2009. 2017 was fuck you to all the politicians.
Okay. Well, that doesn't still discount the evolutionary side of it. This is the evolving nature of it, because perhaps people began to realize that this was no longer working.
Right.
And I think that was the difference between, yeah, you're definitely right when you say that. And so that is enough to not completely discount the interests of the reformists in 2009 in comparison to 2017. Plus, there are a lot of similarities between the two. That's the big, that's of course there are differences, major differences, but right. There definitely are some similarities, and that was what I was investigating, because I wanted to observe the generally just the evolution of the protests and how right. These two were connected.
So what are the similarities for you?
All right, so the youthful demographic is the big one. Now, the Iranian population in itself is very young, as we know. I mean, the Ayatollah back in 1980, after the Saddam Hussein war, about a million Iranians were lost in that war. Mm-hmm. And so they said that we need to breed and we'll give you subsidies if you create more children for the Iranian people. So it ended up creating this huge explosion of youth, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they're present throughout all of the 2009, 2017, they're present throughout it all. And particularly student populations. In 2017, for example, there was lots of grievances surrounding economic unemployment. About 50% of university graduates did not have opportunities to go and get jobs. And you also had 77% were pessimistic about finding jobs too. And so this created a lot of discontent. Mm-hmm. So that's 2017 in regards to that youthful demographic. So that's very interesting in that regard. And the same thing happened with the student populations in 2009. So here we do have connections between upset about unemployment. And now while this touches on the economic, it is still filtered through the youthful lens and the impact of the student populations, right? When I start talking about the decline of religious legitimacy, we can talk about how that I know we touched that the headscarf protests might not actually be entirely connected to 2017. However, I would argue that they are, and for the purposes of this, I would say that the religious discontent in the youthful demographic, just as in 2009, and the decline of religious significance happened in 2017 as well. We saw people taking off the hijab, and we saw people protesting the restrictions of personal freedoms, and this came from the youth, a large section of the youth as well. And that was the big connection in my regard, in regards to youth.
And also social media similarities?
So the social media similarities were in 2009, you had the exposing of what the Revolutionary Guard forces were doing to the populations. We saw videos of Revolutionary Guard forces killing a young girl in the streets of Tehran, where the hashtag Nida came from. Nida Sultan, I believe her name. Yeah. And that exploded on the internet. That was what that infamous video has been seen nearly, I think, about a million times now. On a variety of different YouTube videos, and that was very interesting. And then the same thing happened with the headscarf protesters, where we saw that in 2017, the Girls of Revolution Street, the hashtag Girls of Revolution Street, were using or being filmed and being put up on a variety of different social media websites, being picked up by Western media outlets and things like that. And so when people talk about the significance of social media in regards to a Twitter revolution as if it was some sort of organizing principle to both of these protests, that's not the case. People compare it to the Arab Spring and say that that wasn't, it's similar to that. That wasn't the case. The importance of social media was influencing and exposing what was going on in Iran to an international audience. That's the connection between 2009 and 2017 in regards to social media.
Do you have by any chance, the numbers? Like, how many protesters were 2009 and 2017?
It is debated. Mm-hmm. About the first few months, that it was estimated at nearly 2 million.
Which one?
That's 2009.
2 million for 2009, and what about for 2017?
We're not too sure about that. It's rough estimate. 200,000, a couple hundred thousand, possibly.
Let's say 200,000. Arrests, do you know the numbers for each?
Well, not specifically. In 2009, in the very, very early stages, 2,500 people were arrested, with 30 individuals killed.
30 killed, and what about for 2017?
7,000 individuals were arrested very early on, and 21 protesters killed. This was in the heat of it. 7,000.
7,000. 7,000. Okay.
So it jumped. It was much more aggressive, which was the...
Okay, actually, I'm going to comment on this. Is very interesting because this is... I read something about this. But can I comment on the four things that you mentioned, and you tell me if you agree with it or not?
Of course.
Okay, so... with regards to and this is why I ask you for the numbers, because regarding the social media element, right? Mm-hmm. So what it seems like to people, and this is, I think it's wrong, I'm going to first, is that the 2009 one was a lot more violent than the 2017 one. Because there's a lot, if you look at the social media element of that, the social media element of that was a lot more powerful, because so many more images came out of that, where we have a lot more examples of videos and pictures of the military, the officers, whether they were the besieged or whether they were IRGC or whether they were whatever else, that they were beating people in the street. We had this woman being shot. There are so many examples of that. So people think that the 2009 one was, social media wise, there's a lot more images came out of that was violent. But they think, but the 2017 one, more people had access to higher tech, high definition phone, cameras on their phones. So the technology was a lot better with 2017. So that helped the 2017 social media aspect of it, because more people in the streets had, like, almost everybody was their own reporter, basically, yes. Right? Compared to 2009. So that's but the thing is that I think the analysis that the 2009 one was more violent is wrong, because if you look at the numbers, if you adjust it, relative to the number of protesters, even though we got less violence as a total number wise, you know, as it, you know, come in less violence in 2017, proportionally it was more violent, right? So you got 30, you from 2009, you got 30 deaths out of 2 million protests, but in 2017, you got 21 deaths out of 200,000. Protesters.
Roughly, yeah, I wouldn't want to put my name on those particular.
But I mean, this might be this. Don't you know? Take this with a grain of salt. But the argument is that you got, if you adjust it per the number of adjusted as you know per capita for the number of protesters, then 2017, even though you got less violence, you know, if you look at the total numbers, proportionally it was more violent than 2009. So if you got 2 million people out, it might have become even way more violent than even total number was. You know, so basically they're saying that don't look at 2017. I think the government is less aggressive. If you actually adjust it for the total numbers, the government seems to be even more aggressive than before, right?
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree.
And if you also look at the arrest is very interesting because even though you had less protesters, you had more than twice the number of arrests. So you had like 10% of the amount of protesters compared to 2009, but you had more than double the number of arrests. So that is shocking. Yeah.
Let me just read to you one of the constitutional aspects of Iran, which was I found quite interesting. So in the Iranian constitution, it will state that public gatherings and marches may be freely held, provided arms are not carried, and that they are not detrimental to the fundamental principles of Islam. And that is very interesting, because when you want to talk about what is detrimental to the fundamental principles of Islam, that can just simply be the criticism of the Islamic government. Therefore, peaceful or these protests may not be. You understand what I'm
right.
going for.
Right. And this is actually very interesting, because this brings you to the what started the protest, right? So just to be clear, the 29 protests again was in response to people saying like, "Where's my vote?"
Yes.
This is not democracy. But in 2017, the understanding is that. Originally, it started when some fundamentalists started a protest against Rouhani, so the fundamentalists against the reformists, right? And then to complain about the economy, they were trying to blame the situation in the economy on the president so that to support the fundamentalists versus the reformers. But then the people picked it up, and it got out of the fundamentalists' hands. So basically, they created something that they now regret started, because it went out and became a monster. They became they were like a Frankenstein, and they created a monster that they completely lost control of, and came back against the whole regime, not against the reformers, right? And people, and the reason why this started as an economic thing, and then turned into also civil rights protests, is because I think the memories of 2009 makes it scary for you to go out and protest for civil liberties. But at the same time, the government of the Islamic Republic wants to pretend that they allow certain types of protests. If you're not against the regime, if you have legitimate economical grievances, you can come out and protest, right? So what the people, so this is what confuses people, because people are like, well, we heard this is about economics, but now you're saying it's about civil liberties. Well, the way that works is that they work with each other. The thing is that the people that they want to protest for civil liberties, when a lot of people come out for economical grievances in the street, they feel like, okay, there's a whole bunch of people now in the streets. They have created an environment where we could go out. There's safety in numbers. And now they go join them, and the chance started to change, right? This is, by the way, a lot of people that only have economical grievances get really annoyed with this, because they're like, they were listening to us until you motherfuckers joined us, right? Right? But... So they go out and they're like, oh, inflation is to the roof. Oh, we can't eat anything anymore. Like, prices are going up, but our wages are going down. And that's all, everything you hear. And everybody's saying that, and all of a sudden somebody go like, yeah, and fuck the dictator, and fuck Islam, and people are like, some of the people with economic grievances are like, join in, like, oh yeah, and also that, but some of the people with economic grievances are like, no, I'm not with these people, like, please don't shoot me, I'm not with these people, right? And even I remember that Iranian TV actually sent out reporters to talk to people with the economical grievances to get them, like, tell them, like, yeah, we're protesting and it's fine and the government is listening to us and it is free, but these motherfuckers joined us and ruined everything. So the Iranian government wanted to show, like, listen, look, we allow protests, right? Look, even the protesters are complaining about those other protesters, yeah, which are Zionists. Back then, like, these are foreign agents. These are not part of our people. These people that have economical grievances, they have legit problems, and we're listening to them. These other motherfuckers, they are Zionists. Well,
interesting point, yeah, that you said that. It's funny that you should bring that up, because in 2017 we also had Chance saying forget Gaza. Because Hezbollah was being obviously funded by the Iranian government. Yeah. And so when you had these economic grievances, people are saying, well, why are we caring about the foreign policy of Gaza and the Israeli occupation and things of that nature? And it turned into this entire thing, yeah.
Well, this is why when people ask what was the 2017 protests, what were they about? The answer is,
you,
like,
can't give an answer.
What did you say?
You can't give one answer.
No, it depends who you ask, right? Because in 2009 there was an easier answer to that question. In 2009, like, people feel like their voices are not being heard. People feel like their votes were stolen, and that's why they're in the street. That was the answer, right? But in 2017, you could be like, well, this guy is upset that he can't afford food anymore. That guy is upset that the government is sending all the money that they could spend at home to fight Israel in Gaza. This guy wants to be able to say fuck Islam in public and get away with it. That guy wants the monarchy back. And this guy is all of the above, right? So, and a lot of people are like, yeah, actually all of that, right? So a lot of people, yeah, go ahead.
I feel like that's indicative of the reason why we don't even have a name for it. We don't have a name for the protests.
Right.
Where there is no real, yeah, who knows? And this is why, you know, I would argue that any sort of reformist push, not to lump them together, that's not my intention, because there are definitely different elements to it, which is why I wanted to address economics, because whilst I don't believe that that is the big factor in, or the most significant factor, I should say, in both 2009 and 2017, I still feel that it plays a very important role in it. However, I wouldn't go as far as many Western media publications did and purely address it based on economic issues, which is what a lot of them did.
Right, because it's Islamophobic if you say these people have religious grievances as well, right? So that's why. Exactly. But when it comes to you saying that is the youth element, I think the 2017 crowd was a lot more diverse than the 2009 crowd.
Yes, well, it originally emerged from poorer and much older citizens. In fact,
it didn't even start in Tehran. That was bizarre.
Yeah, I mean, this was a really interesting, but it spread very quickly into places like Qom and the rest of it. But
it actually started in more religious cities.
Exactly, which is why the religious significance is very important in that regard. That was very interesting. But yeah, it started originally because of rising prices on basic subsidies, including bread, milk, and eggs, I think it was, with the main three. Yeah.
Right. And so here's the thing. In 2009, the stereotype was, if you wanted to separate people into different groups, and this was not at all accurate, but this is how people divided the society, not so accurately. They considered, like, okay, we have the upper class liberal elite, right? Liberal elite people that... that just want to be able, the reason why they want civil liberties is just because they want to have parties and dance and sing and listen to foreign music and not follow Sharia law. And these are the people that don't have financial problems, but they're upset that they can't have fun, right? And a lot of people from lower class, which usually are more religious, they're like, oh, these upper liberal elite, like they have stupid grievances, and they're, you know, maybe like they're more in line with the religious authorities a little bit. This was the understanding. I mean, again, this is not accurate, but this is how people saw it, right? Like this is like how conservatives in the United States look at, like, okay, you know, latte drinking liberals. It's like they look at it, right? Sipping. Yeah. So, and if you look at the protesters' demographic in 2019, there were more of this, you know, upper class young liberal university student types, right? Mm. But then you look at 2017. Because it started for economical grievances, like, so the government could be like, oh, we're for the poor, and these motherfuckers, like, they are, like, worried about things that don't matter. But that whole narrative went out the window when it actually started, the 2017 protest started from these lower class, from the working class people, and the younger liberal student type joined later. That made it more diverse. The fact that it wasn't Tehran centric anymore, like it wasn't the capital centric, it was more diverse among smaller cities, even villages, even some, you know, scary to the government, some cities on the borders. And then the students joined later. So it made it more diverse, and it made the country seem more it looked more united against the government, even though it was smaller. It seemed like it came from a more diverse kind of crowd. But sorry, you were going to say something?
Well, it was interesting that you bring that up, because one of the connections as well was, I wouldn't know the exact details on this, but there were instances of Green Movement student population supporters in 2009 actually uniting with working class individuals as well, and creating strikes and things of that nature in 2009 as well. So that was just an interesting little connection where I thought,
yeah, but it wasn't as strong. Like,
no, it wasn't as strong. No, definitely.
The 2009 protest was seen as a university student protest. It was, the connection was so strong that I even remember going on a trip somewhere. People going on a trip somewhere, and they are being telling them that, you're university students. So here's the officers would discriminate against you. So this is what happened. You would go people were checking bags and stuff, right? And somebody, the officer would be like, oh, what, you guys are university students? And they were like, yeah. Like, oh, are you going to cause any trouble? Like that, there was this mental association for officers between, like, oh, if you're a university student, you're high risk, you know, you could be a rebel. And people are like, oh, no, I'm not one of those, right? So this is how close the connection was, right? But in 2017, if you look at the protests, you could see, you know, so many different kind of people, right? You could see people taking off their hijab. You could see people with full-on conservative type hijab, right? Sure. Yeah, like the chador. You could see poor people, rich people. And the main thing, and tell me if you saw this in your research, was that it was not led by anybody.
That was the difference, yeah.
That is the main difference. They had no leaders. It was completely spontaneous, organic. Anybody that tried to claim leadership over it, people denounced them right away. They were like, no, fuck you. This is not, we're not, no politician could come and try to use us. This is a fuck you to the politicians. Like the 29 one was basically the Mousavis, the Karoubis, the reformists telling, yes, people, like, let's make a change. And in 2017, people were like, no leaders. You're part of the problem. So there were no leaders for this, right? And this is what scared the Islamic, the government more, even though this was, I think the 2017 protest, even though it was smaller in size, it scared the government more because they have a solution for the for the 2009 kind of protest. You just go find the leaders, you put them into, you arrest them or you kill them or whatever, and then you take care of the leaders and the movement dies. How, if movements can just start spontaneously out of nowhere, what the hell are you supposed to do with that? That's very scary, I think, to the government.
Definitely. And it's also, I suppose, interesting to look at what the future holds as well. Like, where have these ideas gone? Well, I mean, I'm sure they still exist, and I know that they still exist in Iran. And so what will we begin to see in the future? And that is very interesting. And especially as well, I mean, if this is going back to the economic part of it as well, what if sanctions continue? What happens when we have more economic restrictions placed on Iran, when restrictions on oil exportation? I mean, they have the fourth largest reserves of crude oil, and when you keep restricting these certain foundational economic stabilizers in that region, well, then eventually you'll get these more economic grievances, you'll get more people protesting, you'll get more people concerned, and it's interesting to think what the future may hold in that regard.
Well, I'm gonna give you the opposite, the counterpoint to that is that this government has survived way worse than this, right? This government has survived a situation where it just came out, like, if you go back all the way to 1979, right? Mm-hmm. Think about the Islamic Republic of Iran in that situation. The country was completely bankrupt after that bloody revolution, right?
Mm-hmm.
You had internal conflict between the mullahs and the communists, right? They spent all their resources defeating that. They had no functioning army, right? And then all of a sudden, Iraq, you have a war, 8-year war with Iraq,
mm-hmm.
Funded by United States and Saudi Arabia against Iran.
Mm.
And oil, sales of oil very limited and all of that. And Iran survived all this, not Iran, the Islamic Republic of Iran survived that.
Yeah.
Well, and compared to that, that's what they're dealing with now is nothing compared to that. Compared to that, right now, they have a much stronger army. Their army has been stronger than it has ever been. So imagine this: when the United States, for example, attacked Saddam,
mm-hmm.
Saddam was at its weakest it had ever been military wise.
Which one? 1991 or 2003?
It's three, the latest one. Like, after all the sanctions and everything, Saddam was very weak. Iran right now is at the strongest it has ever been military-wise, and with the amount of influence and enjoys in around the region, right? So it's, and again, when it comes to protesters, I can't see the protesters actually making much of a difference, because you have to understand, like 200,000 people, it's a very small portion of the actual people that have grievances against the government, right? Most people will not come in the streets, right? And even if 2 million people came out again, the thing is that these people don't have guns, okay? These people have no weapons. In the 2014 protests, the government didn't even send the Artesh, their military force,
yes,
against the protesters. They just relied on local police and the local besiege to be able to take care of the people. I mean, they didn't even use a fraction of the forces that they have to respond to the protesters. I mean, the government has a lot more resources to deal with these protesters than it hasn't yet. I mean, think this is a government that has defeated ISIS in many places where the United States, Iraq, and Syria couldn't. And ISIS has machine guns and advanced weapons and a lot of other vehicles and military equipment that they sold for Americans, and they had and military training, and Iranians foreign, even without using their full military, just using their their quotes army, which is this one supposed, and their proxies, they managed to defeat ISIS, right? I mean, these compared to the ISIS forces, these protesters have nothing. The pressure that these protesters put on the Iranian government is not that one day they could talk. I know a lot of Iranians hate that I say this, but the pressure that they put on Iran is a PR problem globally rather than them ever bringing this government down. Like the fact they make Iran look bad and makes it harder for Iran to negotiate globally, because the more these protesters in streets of Iran embarrass Iran's human rights record, the more people in Canada, Australia, United States, UK will be anti-government because they see these images, and the more it will become popular for politicians in these countries to take a stand against the Iranian government. Yeah. That's how these protesters are hurting the government. Not that they could ever, I don't think they could ever be a match for Iran's military force.
Well, I think that speaks to my social media segment in my research, and that the international attention that it drew is possibly the most important thing that's occurring at the moment.
Right.
And that was really interesting. But also, I mean, Iran and the Iranian people, I should say, is very cosmopolitan in that regard. That's interesting. That is very, very interesting. And I mean, we can also look at just the amounts of literature that are coming out of Iran as well. Beautifully written, wonderful writings and poetry and lots of things. One of the examples, I think Christopher Hitchens actually brought this up, and it was the Penn anthology, Strange Times, My Dear, which was just a collection of essays and interesting literature and poetry as well, brought out of Iran in about 2005. So it does show that there's a real...
I mean, every country has beautiful literature.
Oh, of course, yeah. But this really highlighted it, and it was very, very interesting to see that dissent and topics which might be repressed by the government were being spoken about in these sorts of literary senses, and that's very interesting. That's beautiful, and I like that, you know, and hopefully we see a lot more of that.
Right. Yeah. I want to mention, you're talking about the international attention. I think the international attention is now going down.
Yes.
And that's why the government is now feeling more secure to now retaliate for what the people did, especially for the women taking off their hijab and embarrassing Iran on an international basis, you know, internationally.
She still hasn't been released, I don't believe.
No, just recently, I think this was last week or that happened, 550 or 500 restaurants in Tehran just got shut down for being un-Islamic. And then they're hiring, the morality police. They're hiring 2,000 new all-female units. Mm-hmm. 2,000. All female units, and the fact that they're all female to me shows that there is going to be a lot of arrests of women, because men can't really go and grab women, right? Like that's un-Islamic. So the fact that they are doing I think they want to make sure that there is a response, like these protests.
PR friendly as well. Do you think that maybe a PR friendly response to get women somehow involved in that regard to look better?
No. These are women that are going to go out there to arrest women. Arrest women with that they're not having their hijab right or stuff like that. That's the purpose of this, because for them it doesn't make strategic sense to let this go unpunished. They have to. Put yourself in the position of the government in 2009, they wanted for people to regret having the protests, right? Mm-hmm. In 2017, I think this government wants to make sure that the people suffer. If you come out and say like we're going to take our rights, we're going to take off our hijab, and you can't do anything about it. The government will look at this and they think that if they win this, okay, they're going to become motivated to ask for more. So we should retaliate in such a strong way for them to not only not gain anything, lose some of the things that we already have slowly given them, to see that the reaction is going to be strong. Like, they're going to be in a worse position that they already were. Like, they have to regret this. Mm-hmm. But they didn't do this right. I'm guessing here, but they didn't do this right away because they were waiting for the international eyes to go away from Iran. And now they're not going to do it. I mean, it's getting some news attention, but I think it wouldn't get that much. But well,
Iranian news attention. I mean, look at what has just happened last week with the oil tanker and things like that. I mean,
that's getting attention. They want that to get attention. They don't want this to get it. They love the oil tanker. Those things should get attention because those things are showing Iran's dominance around the area, right? They want this stuff not to get as much attention because I think they want to show the Iranian people, like, look, you got your 15 minutes, the Iranian women that, you know, that came out and protest. Basically, I think the message is, like, you got your 15 minutes of fame. The international world clapped while you risked your life. And now when we're going to come back and punish you, they're not going to be there for you.
And they just came,
there will be nothing. You will go to prison. You will suffer. And nobody will come to save you. You got cheered just a little bit. And people call you heroes and stuff. And that's all you're going to get from it.
We're going to arrest you. International recognition and what we can do to assist in this regard. I mean, and as you said, we applauded from afar.
Right.
But what exactly else is going to be done?
That's what the message of the government is going to be. Like, they're going to tell the people that if applause is what you wanted, you got the applause. But nobody's going to come here to get you out of prison. And you're going to see how we will show our authority. You question our authority, and we're going to show you who's in charge right now. We're going to show you that you thought that you got away with protesting, and we didn't come after everybody. You're going to come see that all the things that you wanted we will not give it to you. That's what the message is going to be to them, right? I think we'll see how many arrests are going to happen. They're hiring, like, the country is suffering from such economic hardship right now because of sanctions, and they're spending their resources on hiring more people to arrest. And they're installing cameras in streets right now because women wanted to see, you know how I told you about the letter that I put in my bag just to be able to get a little bit more territory of freedom? What women are doing in Iran right now is the law in Iran says that you should wear the hijab in public area, not, you don't need to wear it in your own private spaces, right? Just in public area. And women are trying to take over their cars. So they're saying, my car is part of my own private area. So if I, based on the law of Iran, as soon as I get in my car, I should be able to take off my hijab. And religious people are saying, no, everybody can see you in your car. It's all glass. You shouldn't be able to take it off. And the women are saying, no, this is based on the law. This is my own private area, so I should be able to take it off. So they're trying to classify their cars as the private area. So a lot of women, to be able to change the laws like this, they're basically taking their car, their hijab off while they're driving. And now the government is installing cameras in bridges and in roads to arrest women that are not wearing their hijabs in their cars. Like, this is what they're spending their resources on.
Yeah.
Right.
And especially, I mean, it's like I said, it still speaks to the and their foreign policy as well, which is possibly one of the bigger grievances as well in 2017. Why are you spending more money elsewhere when you could be helping internal affairs?
Right. But if you really want to tackle Iran's government, Islamic Republic instead of Iran, because a lot of people want to differentiate the Iranian people with the government. So. Mm-hmm. But people underestimate the Islamic Republic, right? A lot of these things that they do is evil, but it makes strategic sense, okay? Yeah. It makes absolute strategic sense. Iran has been able to get away with a lot more shit than before because of its investment in these foreign adventures in its neighborhood, right? Like, Iran has become such an important piece of the puzzle, like solving it, like, because they have their hands in everything, they could cause chaos everywhere they want, and they could solve, they can defeat ISIS, or they could cause a mess in Lebanon if they want to, right? So it becomes almost impossible for a country like United States to just attack them, where they have their tentacles all over where U.S. presence, where yeah. U.S. has interests, right?
Well, just touching on that point, I mean, it's very interesting. As you have said, the Islamic Republic of Iran has survived a lot, but so has Persian culture. So, like, for example, you guys all still speak Farsi, which is the really interesting thing. And, you know, they didn't let the Arabic language dominate the scene. So Persian culture has survived a lot too. In fact, you know, I mean, we haven't spoken about this yet, but the 1906 constitutional reforms are still were spoken about in 2009 as well, actually, and in the later days of the 1979 revolution. So there is still a lot of underlying culture which is being expressed and exposed, and I think it's very important that we need to highlight that. And this is what I want to do as an academic. I want to highlight these instances and right. make it more mainstream.
So if you're going into that right at the end, let's go into that. I want to just compare the protests a little bit more, but okay. I want to touch on that. And I want you to, if you're highlighting that, I want you to also highlight the ugly side of that as well. And I will tell you the ugly side of what you just said as well. Okay. So let me just see. So we mentioned the WHO, the students versus more of a diverse crowd. We mentioned the WHERE, more Tehran focus or more big city focus than compared to 2017 was more... it was more diverse, even in smaller cities, smaller villages. It didn't even start in Tehran. It didn't even start in the capital. And the WHERE is actually a very important with 2017 one, because a lot of this was happening in places where the government fears the most, because it's close to the borders where separatist groups are. So the Kurds were joining the protests. That's, you know, the Kurds want autonomy. And the Arabs in Khuzestan, well, that's very scary. Now we have people in Sistan, Balochistan, close. So, and the Azerbaijan people, like, so these people protesting represent something more than people just causing some embarrassment for the government. Or so people in Tehran protesting is bad for the government because it's a huge PR problem on a global scale, right? Mm-hmm. But people in Azerbaijan, Khuzestan, Sistan, Balochistan, and Kurdistan, in these places, people protesting, that goes beyond just PR problems.
So you think it creates more than just noise in that regard?
Yes, that's because people that start protests there, all of a sudden the separatists, like the people that want independence from Iran, that's actually more scary to the government than people just complaining about civil liberties. Right. So the government will, if they were going to go like aggressive towards people just demanding civil liberties, if people there are protesting, they will lose their shit. They will not. They will rain hell on you if you want to start protesting these areas. Right.
Yeah.
Like my uncle died fighting the Kurds as part of the government's army by the Kurds. Right. But. So I know, and this civil war between Iran Islamic Republic and Kurdistan, the Kurdish part of Iran, and you could say both because Kurdistan is an area as well. But this was a civil war that I never knew. Like it's wiped out of our history books. Like there's nothing, internal struggles is never happened, right? Like I learned many years later that apparently there was a civil war in our country and my uncle was involved in it, right? So I didn't the only war that we know about was the Iran-Iraq war. Like they didn't tell us about it. So
is that part of the unifying narrative? Is that the intent, obviously, to unify this particular narrative?
You didn't want to, it's not in our history books because you don't want to tell kids that, by the way, part of the country rose up against the government. No, all the enemies are foreign. Even if it looks internal, it's because of foreign agents, right? Foreign Zionists and the imperialist West or something like that. It's obviously it's not the pure Iranian people. It's just a misguided few agents of foreign entities. That's what they're meant to.
You say that because actually in 2009, when Twitter was going to undergo a what was it? I think it was an update, I believe, some sort of maintenance update. The United States actively asked Twitter to suspend that update so that they could continue to monitor what was occurring in Iran at the time of the 2009 protests, which was very, very interesting in that regard as well. Oh. And so, yeah.
So with regards to the Persian culture thing, so you know how I mentioned to you, like, there's a very simplistic classification that was like upper class, lower class, liberal, conservative. That is all gone now. Like, now a lot of people are thinking, oh, people, Iranian people versus the government, all of us, like something like that, right? Even before there was a little bit of that, but now even more because it was more mixed, right? People are saying, like, you know, we don't have just one grief, you know, one problem. It's everything. It's mm-hmm. like these people in power, they fucked up everything. Mm-hmm. Their religious authority, civil liberties, economy, everything. Everything, like, oh, what's your grievances? Is it this? Yes. Is it this? Yes, as well. Is it that as well? Like, yes, yes, yes to everything. Everything. Mm-hmm. We have a problem with everything. Okay. So, but there's another too simplistic classification that has now changed, and this is something I grew up with, right? And that was the two camps of the religious conservatives, right? Mm-hmm. Versus the nationalists.
Yes.
Right? So you have Islam first versus Iran first.
Yes.
Right? And I grew up in an environment of people being more nationalist than religious, right? So this gap was way more clear at the beginning of the revolution. Like, even Khomeini, for example, himself hated nationalism. He hated the concept of Iran at all. Like, this was for him. The 1979 Islamic Revolution was not an Iranian revolution. It was an Islamic revolution. And it was not meant to stop at the borders of Iran, right? Mm-hmm. And they asked him, like, what's your feeling going back to Iran, like, on the plane? And he said, nothing. Like, I don't care. He doesn't care about Iran. He cared about Islam, right? So, but I think that was his narrative. But the thing, the government changed its tune a little bit because of the Iran-Iraq war. Because they were Muslims fighting Muslims, right? Especially with Iraq, it's mostly Shia. I mean, Saddam is Sunni, so you can't even use the Shia-Sunni narrative that much. So you had to start playing the Iran-Iran narrative a little bit. So it got Iran nationalism got mixed with Islamism. So the government had to give in to some nationalist narrative.
Well, that you should say that, because at that time as well, you had more pushes towards nationalism and popular sovereignty, particularly because of also the bickering between the socialists and the conservatives as well. And so these more reformist members of parliament actually took away certain elements of the conservative nationalist and moved towards popular sovereignty, and made their own little pushes for it as well, which was interesting.
Right.
So it became more independent about Iran rather than...
Right. So...
Yeah,
Right. I mean, the way that you play... If you wanted to focus on Islam, but realize that Iranian people are way too nationalistic for you to completely ignore that, the way you solve that problem is by claiming Iran is God's chosen place for Mehdi to come back or something like that, right? So you marry some nationalistic arguments, you just squeeze it into Islam somehow, or Velayat Faqih version of Islam.
Yeah.
But the nationalists, either the less religious or the non-religious nationalist type, they didn't buy any of that. They see these people as Islam first, Islam second, Islam first, Iran second, mm-hmm. and they were like, no, fuck it, Iran, or get the fuck out, right? Mm-hmm. So, a lot of these people think that Islam is a foreign invasion. You have two romanticized view of the past, the glorification of the past. There's two versions of that glorification, right? You have the people that say that Islam was this glorious Persian Empire. It was a superpower. It was just only two superpowers in the world. It was the Romans and it was Persians, and eventually it was the Greek and it was Persians. And then even after it fell down, Iran still remained a superpower. It came back. It was, you know, it was all during the Sasani times until this backwards barbaric Arabs came and destroyed our superior culture and ruined everything. Like, Iran pre-Islam was heaven on earth, right? So they have this, you know, and they just romanticize everything about how what Iran was. A lot of these people are converting from Islam to Zoroastrianism, or they have, like, I remember my uncle from Nowruz, for example, which is the Persian New Year. Most people bring a Quran, and he wouldn't even put a Quran. He would put the Shahnameh instead of the Quran. A lot of people have, like, Zoroastrian symbols, Zoroastrian necklace. My mom used to have a Zoroastrian necklace. And just celebrate Zoroastrian symbols as this pre-Arab Persian Empire, you know, celebrating that. They celebrate the little things that is still predates Islam from Iran. For example, the Nowruz, the New Year, is it predates Islam, so they're obsessed with that because it's the few things that the charge
they still celebrate. Yeah,
the charge ambassadori or like jumping over fires. They recognize these things as things that are pre-Islamic, and they hold on to that because it's
all. Do you still think that there's a bit of fascination as well with 1953 as well, and Mossadegh as well in that regard?
No. There are some people there that like that, but not that much. But the idea that like we are, you know, we're Persian, not Arab, we're Aryan, Iran means the land of Aryans, and this is why racism gets a little bit in there. Like some of the chants that you hear in the streets were like, "We are Aryans, not Arab worshippers." Okay. This was one of the chants. So you see, I'm an atheist activist. I'm an anti-Islam activist, but I'm also a humanist, right? So when I work with anti-Islam activists in Iran, you see a lot of narratives and a lot of arguments that sounds like the alt-right in Western countries, right? I mean, when the rise of the alt-right happened in Western countries, a lot of the things that these people were saying was much a milder version of what I grew up with, right? Yeah. What I grew up with was people saying, oh, these barbaric backwards Arabs, they came and they say that Islam is a barbaric religion that only barbaric Arabs are deserving of. The only religion that is deserving of the superior race of the Iranian people is the Zoroastrian religion. This is a religion of desert people.
And so this touches on the ugly side, as you were saying,
yes,
of that culture. Yeah.
Right. Okay. So what I do with my activism I'm not trying to say like every atheist activist in Iran is like this, right? There are many humanist ones that are also fighting racism, right? And one thing we're trying to do is introduce a lot of these atheists to Arab atheists to show, like, look, there are many Arabs that are also fighting this ideology. Yeah. This is not a race thing. This is an ideological battle, not an ethnic battle, right?
That's very important.
Yeah, it's very important. But I remember when I was a kid, my aunt said to me that, oh, I have this Arab friend that she's so wonderful that I don't even consider her an Arab. That's how good she is. So, right? But it's not like that if somebody said something anti-Arab, it was like racist and unusual. No, if you said something that was not anti-Arab, that was unusual. That was weird. Like, I remember at some point saying something that this is racist, you know, is Nejat Parasi at some point, and people called me a dirty Arab lover. This is like this is a very, I mean, now it's getting a lot better. People are being influenced by Western, you know, by Enlightenment thinking coming from because of social media stuff. But it was like nobody that I know of in my entire social circle ever argued that Arabs are not worthy of blaming and looking down upon. Like, everybody accepted that Arabs are deserving to be hated. They call them alligator eaters. Like, I don't know, because I think in Shahnameh, which is a book that these people worship like the Quran, there's these Zoroastrian types, right? They're referred to as alligator eaters, so that's why they call them alligator eaters. I tried alligators, they're delicious, so I don't know why that's an insult. So there's two versions of that. The glorification of the Persian Empire before the Arab invasion, and the glorification of Zoroastrianism as an ethno-religion for the Iranian people, for the Aryan race, right? There was a research that showed that Iranians actually have a lot of Arabs in their blood, by National Geographic, and they people in Iran were so angry they were like, this is a Zionist conspiracy. Everything is Zionist.
Everything's always a Zionist conspiracy.
Yeah, this is something that both sides agree on, Zionist conspiracy. But I told my uncle that, actually, did you know that we have Arab in our blood? And my uncle told me, if I knew I had any Arab in me, I would burn it off of my skin. Right. And this is something that unites this nationalist types with the religious conservatives, their hatred for at least the Gulf Arabs. Right. The second glorification is the glorification of Iran before the Islamic Revolution. Of 1979, as if in the Shah Pahlavi times everything was hunky-dory and everything was amazing, and
necessarily the case.
they exaggerate how amazing everything was. So you can see even in these last in the 2017 protests, some of the chants were Reza Shah, Ruhat Shah. So there were, you know, blessing the Pahlavi dynasty, even though most of them were never alive during the Pahlavi dynasty.
It's such a fascinating, but I think you touched on a very, very important distinction between the ideological perspectives versus the ethnic perspectives,
right?
And that has, I feel like that has a lot more underlying cause in large amounts of the youthful population in Iran. I would say maybe Would you say that they might have grown out of this sort of thinking in regard? Or would you say that it's still very prevalent?
It's getting more polarized. So I see more than before, more than I used to when I was in Iran. I see more Iranians, anti-racist Iranians, coming out and saying that, you know, I'm against racism. I'm not anti-Arab in any shape or form. But I also see the other side getting more extreme in their anti-Arab rhetoric. Like, I remember that my people saying, like, oh, yeah, we're Aryans, right? In Iran means the land of Aryans. I remember, my name Armin means the guardian of the Aryan land, right? My brother's name is just straight up Aryan. But I don't remember people saying that we're boasting about being Aryans, like saying, like, oh, we're Aryans, we're not Arab worshippers. Like, Arab worshippers, but what they mean by Arab worshippers is, like, when you pray as a Muslim, you're worshipping Arabs as your masters, and they consider anyone that accepts Islam as a traitor to Iran, because it's a foreign intervention in Iran, right? So I never seen this level of hostility. Let me tell you the level of hostility. There was a hashtag that was going around on Twitter in Persian that said, a mullah for every tree in Persian. So basically what the hashtag was suggesting, that when this government falls eventually, when we topple the government, we'll make sure that every tree has a mullah hanging from it.
Yeah,
you seen that? There was another thing that I saw was a poll, asking people in Iran to what to do with the mullahs once we eventually get rid of the Islamic Republic. Should we kill all of them or just kill the leadership and put the rest of them in forced labor? Also, should we kill their families as well or let their families go? Like, so they were asking, what the poll was asking, whether we should kill women and children or not, right? But there was no option for there's so many people voting, but there was no option for not killing anybody. And also, more recently, there was a mullah that was killed, and the hashtag that was going around was Ahunkashi, which means killing mullahs. And a lot of people were supporting, like, yes, finally the day has come where mullahs have to look.
When we see a lot, what are we saying?
Let me check Ahunkashi, how I could check that right now, actually. So I have to get Persian keyword. Good question. Let me see. Notes. Ahunkashi. By the way, I'm going to put this on YouTube, and I'm hoping YouTube is not going to think that I'm talking about killing and stuff. And YouTube is sometimes very stupid, and it thinks that I'm saying these things, which I'm not. So I'm hoping that they recognize that.
Yeah. Would it help if we clarified that?
I don't think so. Okay, let me type here. Hold on. No, because it's usually just a machine. So I don't think they will. No. You have to get enough people to take you seriously to somebody to come check it manually, which is really unfair to people that don't have large platforms. Okay, so if I go to Twitter. So this was a while ago, so it must have died down. But I wonder if Twitter will give you a total stat for the whole thing. Okay, so if I click. So if I click on the hashtag Ahunkashi, what did I get? Where is does it say the number anywhere?
No,
hashtag stats. Maybe Twitter is not giving me a number. So maybe if there's a website that does that, I'm not sure. I'll look it up and I'll let you know.
Okay.
But it was a big deal for a while.
So interested was because I'd be curious to see how ingrained this is in the entirety of the population.
Well, I could tell you that when we came out and said that this is wrong, I lost a lot of my Iranian support. A lot of the people that were, like, half of them stayed, half of them supported me, saying, yes, Armin, you know, you're right. But a lot of people that were defending my anti-Islam rhetoric, when I said that, you know, I suggested that you shouldn't, you know, become the monsters that you're trying to defeat, right? So many of the people that supported me from Iranian Twitter accounts came out and some unfollowed me, tweeted against me. They're so disappointed. Like, how could you say that you're against Islam if you're against killing of mullahs? Like, how could you pretend that?
That just speaks volumes to the importance of, separating ideas from people. It's just,
Yeah, I know. I mean, yeah, so I mean is so be careful about. Let me see if I could show the tweet that I posted. Ah, come on, it's not here. Oh no, I have to search for my name in English, not in Persian here. Anyways, I'll try to find it. I basically posted something. Yeah, never. I can't find it. Sorry, but I posted something, and a lot of people also responded to that. I publicly came out against it. But I wasn't the only one. So there are other people that posted against it, but they were the minority. That's basically the problem with this. Anyways, yeah. Sorry, go on. I'm talking too much.
That's okay. Yeah. No. Essentially, I mean, we've pretty much addressed most of the comparisons in that regard. Between 2009 and 2017, but it's just as you said, in 2017 it is so hard to distinguish between who's protesting what, whose grievances lie where. And I think over time, and as more literature will come out, academic literature comes out, hopefully we can narrow that down a little bit, because like I said, it's pretty sparse at the moment in regards to that. And which is why, you know, when talking about 2017, I was getting majority of my sources from news outlets who were covering it as it happened rather than the rest. And yeah, so it's interesting.
Can I tell you what has happened? I can tell you about two things. First of all, regards to this Persian culture thing, how we come full circle and how things are more complicated than people. I'll give you an example for you to see how upside down everything is compared to before. Okay. We now have groups in Iran, a rising new way of thinking about it, and I will give you the sources to go check out the people that are making content about this, and they're becoming more and more popular. Okay. And these are people that are anti-Islam to their core. Okay. And they are pro Zoroastrian, pro the Persian Empire, pro anti Mullah, and they are defending the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Strange.
Right? Yes. And they are they're becoming more and more influential. And their narrative is, and this is why it's strange, because their narrative is, first of all, we don't like Islam. But if this government falls, but we will sacrifice anything and everything for the sake of Iran. And if tolerating this government is what is needed right now to keep Iran together, we will tolerate this government. And they are very, very anti these protesters.
That narrative has been expressed somewhat in 2017 as well. It's not the explicit ask to topple the government.
Right.
Which is why a lot of these people aren't even aligned on their goals and intentions.
Right. Mm. So even if you, let's put these people aside, I'll get back to these people. But even there are a lot of people that are just in general, not just these people that are against the government. They say, the people that are for toppling the government, they call themselves Barandazam, Barandaz people, right? Hashtag Barandazam. They are a lot of people in Iran that don't like the government. They say, look at what happened in Iraq when Saddam fell. You had 10 years of chaos. Look at what happened in Syria. Look at what happened in Libya. They say, I don't like this government and fuck this government and everything it stands for. But I'm not part of these protests. I have a job. I'm making a living. I'm taking care of my family. And if this government falling means we have to go through a civil war and we have to go through the mess and chaos that Iraq and Syria and Libya had to deal with, then fuck it, let's keep this government. Like they say, like, these protesters, they're gonna, and also a lot of these people are against foreign intervention. They're like, I don't like this government, but I don't want any US meddling in my country either, right? So there are different narratives against what people saying, like, you know what, no, we don't like this government, but we're against the government falling as well, right? So, but then these neo-Zoroastrians, this is what I call them, right? These neo-Zoroastrians or these ethno-nationalists, they take this argument that a lot of people have to a completely insane level. And this is what they say. They say, not only we want this government to stay because we want Iran to stay together. Oh, another thing most people say is that, look, if Iran, we don't want an inch of Iran to go away. Like they say, I don't care about Islam or anything like that. But if this government falls, the Kurds want independence, the Azeris want independence, the Baluchis want independence, and the Arabs also want independence, and Iran is going to turn into seven different pieces. And I will go, any government that kills any one of these separatists and crushes them, I'm for that, even if they're theocrats, right? Like, even though I don't like this government, I want something to hold this country together. They're like, they will give up their, they say, I will give up my children if it means defending every inch of this land. That's what
just
this,
let you know, sorry, my
they say I will sacrifice my own children if it means defending every centimeter of this land, right? So they're like, if the devil was ruling over Iran, and I don't care, I will support the devil if the devil was holding Iran in one piece. That's what they would say, right? But now these ethno-nationalist type people, these neo-Zoroastrians, are saying that, listen, this government that we have is actually a stealth Zoroastrian government, okay? So they're saying, are you there? Oh, I think you got cut out. All right, so what these neo-Zoroastrian people are saying is that this current government is a stealth Zoroastrian government, that it is basically a Zoroastrian government hidden, somehow secretly Zoroastrian, which is ridiculous, but let me tell you what they're saying. They're saying basically there's this, like, is Iran, you know, it seems to be protected by this hidden force, like by Ahura Mazda, which is like the Zoroastrian god. And because it went through so many invasions, it went through the Alexander invasion, through the Mongol invasion, through the Islamic Arab invasion, but it still kept its identity, it kept its culture. All these other countries, when they became Arabized, their language changed, their culture changed, their writing changed. But Iran, through all this, it kept on coming back, and the people kept their culture and their identity. So they're saying there's this hidden force that is protecting Iran. And they're saying, like, they think that Shia Islam is basically an excuse for Iran to keep its identity. They're saying, like, even when Iran was invaded by Islam, it came up with a different, this is not historically accurate, because Shia Islam started, you know, the first Shia government was in Egypt, and Iran was Sunni for a long time. But they're saying, like, you know, with the Safavid Empire, what happened was Iran came up with this way to be able, even though it was dominated by Islam, it basically stayed Islamic, but I tried to come up with a version of Islam of itself, which is Shia Islam, so that it at least could be separate from the real Islam, which is Sunni Islam. So these anti-Islam people in Iran, they're saying Shia Islam is not really Islam. It's a fake Islam and an excuse for Iran to be able to keep its identity. And they're saying, like, and they're saying, like, look, IRGC represents, like, the Aryan Guards, or and this government is based, and Khamenei is unknowingly something, you know, fulfilling the role of a Shah or the role of a king. He doesn't know it, but there's something.
Islamic Republic, simply to keep the foundations or the structure of a state.
These people are anti-republic, like, they don't like democracy, right? They want a king, they want a monarchy, right? They say the Islamic Republic, they hate both parts of it. They hate the Islamic part and the republic part, right? But they're saying that this government, the Khamenei himself, maybe unknowingly, because there's something within the Aryan DNA that is guiding him, and he doesn't know it, but he's fulfilling the role of a king. And, like, they're putting the picture of him next to the picture of, like, Dariush, the king of the Hachamanish dynasty. So these are the things they're saying. I don't know, are these things useful for, like, you said that that's the next things you're doing in your research, right? These are the things you might be interested in looking into. I'll send you some of, yeah.
Because this, I mean, a lot of the stuff that you've just said, I had very little idea on, and that's really, really interesting, so thanks for that. But, for sure. In regards to moving on to different parts of the research, it would be really interesting now to look at the different dynamics of people in the 2017 protests, to actually investigate the small groupings of what seems to be such a large, diverse grouping. And that would be a really interesting starting point.
Yeah, actually, this is the most. If you can solve this problem, you have no idea how important this is. If you can do this, because most people that you're talking to, they're trying to claim that their side is the majority, right? So if you talk to the pro-government side, they're like, oh yeah, these people with grievances, they're just like few government, a few foreign agents, few people. That's most Iranian people love their government, right? If you talk to the people that want the government to fall, they're like, most Iranians want this government to fall. If you talk to the people that are against the government, but they don't want the government to fall, they're saying that their side is the dominant, you know, and nobody really knows. There's no reliable polling. There's no way to know which side. By the way, my guess is that the people that are still pro the government are between 10 million and 20 million. So if you do, this is just a guess, but I don't know. But the people that are anti-government, obviously, I think they're the majority. I mean, I think that's a pretty safe bet, but not enough against the government to be against toppling it because they're afraid of, I don't know. So how would you go about and figuring out how many people are on each side? Because the protest might give you as an exaggeration of how many people are willing for this government to fall, because that's the most visual thing that you see. So I don't know, how would you figure this out?
Well, quantitative isn't my particular interest. However, if I were going to go along those lines, first I would have to go through and analyze the methods that others have actually used. In fact, I have recently come across a study which described the quantitative, areas on public opinion in Iran. And when I find that again, I will send that to you, because it took me a while to find before. It's somewhere in the
Is it the trust research? Because the only one that I found that it was.
It's an academic source on JSTOR. It's a
Okay. Yeah. Oh, wow. Send that to me. I want to see that. My God, yeah. I want to review that. Gee, that's amazing. Do you want to like partner up with somebody that is has more, so you can mix your analysis with his data analysis, like together?
I mean, quantitative data isn't my particular thing. So yes, but analysis is. So yeah, for sure. I would love to do something like that.
Go on. Sorry.
This is obviously all down the line as well, but it could be a really interesting dissertation. I don't know.
How do you speak Persian?
No.
How do you do all of this with the language barrier? Like, do you have like people translating or?
A lot of the literature is translated. There are obviously boundaries and things like that. For example, I would love to read the studies that came out of Iranian universities, for example. And you could only, you know, read the English ones, which is unfortunate. But a lot of academics have devoted a lot of time to Iran and the issues within it. However, as I've previously said, the 2017 protests are still a little bit lacking in that area, which is it's always exciting when you come across an area which hasn't been addressed that much, because that means that there is a gap in the literature and that there is room for more research and improvement and a better understanding of it.
Are you interested in interviewing people from like involved in these protests?
100%. I would eventually have to start doing methods, especially if I was going to do a thesis.
Because I could put you in touch with a lot of people. I mean,
that would be amazing. That would be incredible.
But it might be, most of my contacts are atheists, so it might ruin your data.
But I mean, that's just one of those things which you would address in the methods and say that that's where a fault may lie and things like that.
Right. And also, where can people find your research? Is that publicly available?
It's not at the moment. No, it isn't at the moment. But if you want, I will send you through a few things, and you can pop it up wherever you want to pop it up.
Really? I could post it publicly?
Yeah,
all your hard work for free, like that?
All my hard work for free.
Wow, that's fair. Thank you. You're very generous. Where can people, like, do you have social media, YouTube, Facebook, anything like that? Do you want people can come reach out to you, ask you questions, follow you?
At the moment, I haven't actually set up anything. I haven't had the time to do that yet, but I will eventually set some things up. And if that's okay with you, I might send that through to you at a later date.
Sounds good.
Organize some stuff.
And can you come back and talk about more stuff?
Yeah, of course. Anytime you want me.
and is there anything that you think I should have asked or that you wanted to talk about and I didn't ask, or anything that you wanted to say really that was important but I didn't let you?
Oh, no, definitely not. Because I think what was really interesting about this entire conversation was that I gave you the rough academic sense, or the crash course in the academic sense of what was occurring and things like that, and then you compared it to the boots on the ground understanding of what was occurring. And I think that is often missed in academic literature, especially if there aren't first-person, straight-to-face methods being used in the literature. Right. And so, yeah, it's always very, very interesting to see those differences in the dichotomy between the two and whether or not they hold up to what's actually happening.
Right. Next time you come, I'll show you my stamp for my book. Just, yeah. By the way, a lot of people, let me just tell you something very interesting, right? So like I said, the 2017 protesters are anti-government as a whole. They're not for the reformists against the conservatives. They say they're all part of the same problem, right? Mm-hmm. So they see the people that are for the 2009 protesters, like if you're still for that protest, you're part of the problem, because the 2009 protesters were people that were supporting the reformists, right? Mm-hmm. So they're saying by 2017, you should have matured enough to know that you shouldn't be supporting the reformists, right? So the 2017 protest is also against everything that the 2009 protest was standing for.
Mm-hmm.
By most of them people, right? So the scary thing is that my 1997 vote for Khatami, I mean, I was a teenager or something back then, right? But when I tell on my Persian show, because we have an Atheist Republic Persian show, Jomhuriye Bi Khodayan, by the way, search it on YouTube, Jomhuriye Bi Khodayan. When I tell people there that I voted for Khatami, people are like, oh, you voted for one of the reformers. You're a traitor, right? So some of these people from... I'm like, dude, this was 1997. This whole narrative of they're all part of the problem. Like, all of you guys... First of all, a lot of you were babies back then. And a lot of you that voted, like... During that time, you were also voting for Khatami. Like, almost everybody you knew voted for Khatami at the time. This whole narrative that the reformists are part of the problem is a 2017 thing. It wasn't a 1997 thing. So why are you holding it against me now that I voted for reformists? Like, they are guilting you for even back then voting for reformists. Like, like it's a crime. Like, right? A lot of these people are so anti-anything Iranian government that just having it in your record that you voted for a reformist will mark you as a traitor.
Well, that was really interesting because, I mean, now that I've done the comparison, perhaps I should do the contrast next. That can
okay.
be, that would be a very interesting thing to delve into. And then, of course, as you said, you have the different sub individuals and groupings organizing in that regard. Right. So that can be... So
if you're saying, like, oh, I'm for Rouhani, right? Or for Musavi, or for Khatami, or any of these reformists, they call you a Malikesh. They're like, you're doing the government's bidding. Like, they're like, oh, you're not, some of them even go as far as saying that you're a paid agent by the government, right? So, they just like the government accuses everybody they don't like as being Zionist or imperialist puppets, a lot of these anti-government types, every time you say anything they don't like, they're like, oh, you're paid by the Islamic Republic. I'm like, yeah, sure. I fought most of my activist life. I fought against anything Islamic, and I burned a Quran on YouTube. Well, right, and then like,
position is just that polarization is exactly the problem in many Western countries as well. For example, we're missing a centrist voice. We're missing that middle ground.
Well, I mean, this is why the Islamic Republic is, I think, is pretty safe, because it doesn't have any major opposition, and there's no organized opposition. All the organized opposition, every time there is some movement for opposition, they became extremely divided against each other, right? The strongest, most funded opposition against the Islamic Republic of Iran is the MEK. Yeah. The Mujahideen Khalq, came out of the communist merging with, it's a weird hybrid of Islam and communism.
Not particularly, because when you look at Baathism, for example, we can talk about how that mixed in with a little bit of Islamic tradition as well, which is very interesting as well.
But the MEK is just a cult, it's a terrorist cult, and is hated by majority of, like, if Iranian people, okay, the number one thing that unites most Iranians is their hatred for Arabs. Right? The second thing that unites them is their hatred for the Islamic Republic, less because there's still Islamic Republic has still some, actually, no, that's the third thing. The second most hated group among Iranian peoples is the MEK, the Mujahideen Khalq. So the fact that they're the most organized and funded one shows to me that there is no serious opposition. There's no serious opposition. And when Saudi Arabia and United States go and fund the MEK, to me, it shows that they have no fucking idea about how to attack this government. Because if they had done any amount of analysis, they should have known that the MEK has no hope ever to becoming a popular opposition in Iran against this government. They should hire you and me.
That's really interesting. Well, it's I mean, I suppose this goes into the idea of legitimate opposition. So where is the legitimate opposition coming from? As you said, you have different areas of criticism. You have people that literally want to topple the government. Right. You have people that want to keep the government. And therefore, and you also have the reformists which want to change within the government. And so this leads into the idea of where is the most legitimate form of criticism going to come from. And that, I think, is going to be the most polarizing debate in this regard.
But the polarization exists even among the people that want to topple the government, right?
Yeah.
So well, among the people that want to topple the government, you have the monarchists, you have the MEK. Recently, we had a new group that was the Farish Guard, and they became divided right the second they were created, right? Mm. So, like, it's like there is not, like I mean, the Islamic Republic is just sitting there and just laughing at these people. Like, if you're my opposition, I can sleep safe at night knowing that you're my opposition.
Perhaps
right?
Or we might even see division in the conservative aspects of the Islamic Republic.
When Khamenei dies.
Yes,
The only tiny hope I see for the people that want to topple the government is what will happen when Khamenei dies. The division and the competition for the supreme, for who becomes the supreme leader, is the only, I think, the, in my opinion, the only chance people have. They, whatever chaos is caused by that, the division between the conservatives, because right now they're pretty fucking united, right? That is their only chance, that's their only shot, and I think they're going to screw it and nothing is going to happen, but that is their only shot. And if that passes without the government, the Islamic Republic falling, I think they're here to stay for another 40 years.
Well, that doesn't sound optimistic, but I feel like there is a shred of hope in that, and I think that that's a good place to leave it, because I think that's a nice little hope.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you so much. I know I talk too much, but you admitted that you said everything. Yeah,
I have no issue with you talking much if I learn a lot.
But you admit to saying everything you wanted to say, right? So because people are going to complain in the comment section, like, Armin, you have a guest on and you talk most of the time. I'm sorry, I'm trying, okay? But our guest is saying that he said everything he wanted to say, correct?
That is fine, yes. I've said
all right. Okay. And you're going to come back, right?
I will come back if you want me to, of course.
Okay, so people leave in the comment section, please leave the questions that you have for Ash, so that next time he comes, we have some of your questions to ask him. Okay, so leave your questions, and I'll let him. I promise I will let him answer.
I know. Thanks for having me, by the way. Thank you.
What?
Thanks for having me.
Oh, no, I love having you. And yeah, please send me those research papers. I'm gonna use it as a source. I'm gonna share it around, by the way, among a lot of my. By the way, you're going to get a lot of people from Iran are going to attack you by saying, like, why are you talking about you're not even Iranian, you've never been here, so you have no right talking about this. Don't let those people get to you, okay?
No worries.
Okay.
No issue with that.
Atheists are under attack in many places. If they were Christians, their voices would be heard. If they were Jews, their voices would be heard. If they were Muslims, their voices would be heard. But they are atheists, and not many seem to be listening. Let's make it difficult for them to ignore us. We have built a global community, and now we are tearing down geographic, cultural, and language barriers so we can find each other and support each other. In the last decade, we have built the largest atheist community in the world. Now we are doing the same in other languages. With your help, we have started Atheist Republic in Persian and Arabic.
انضميت مؤخرا لأسرة Atheist Republic وحيصير عندي بودكاست باللغة العربية.
As we grow, we can dedicate more time, staff, and resources to start doing the same in Spanish, Portuguese, Malay, Bengali, Urdu, Hindi, and other languages. We are providing community, support, informative content, and amplifying the voices of those who need protection, especially in countries where people feel isolated simply for their lack of belief. We want to be there for them, and we are only getting started. Help us get there. Check in the description for ways you can support our projects.